My name is Oksana Zoymenicht. I was born as Oksana Tsubka. I studied physics, graduated Shevchenko University in Kyiv, did my PhD in radiobiology, also in Kyiv, at the Institute of Cell Biology and Genetic Engineering, and published as Oksana Kostyuk. And for a while I did my postdoctoral research then abroad. Right now I'm located in Berlin. I work for Max Delbruck Center for Molecular Medicine. And I work in the Department of Strategic Operations and Research Funding, with main duties basically supporting our researchers with our funding opportunities, developing collaborations with international partners, and helping with grant applications. I am a co-founder of the Ukraine Network, Ukrainian Academic International Network. And here in Germany, we established as a formal organization, an NGO called German Ukrainian Academic Society, of which I co-founder and also serving as a managing director since 2016.
Let's now turn to the second section, it's academic life in Ukraine. Why and how did you choose the study and or your research field? And which is your alma mater in Ukraine?
Yeah, so I liked natural sciences and mainly biology, life sciences since early on. And at age of 14, I got a place to study at Republican Special School, Physics Mathematics School, that people in Ukraine know as FISMAT in Kyiv. Because originally I grown up in south of Ukraine in Mykolaiv region. So I moved to Kyiv and having such a pedigree, one would then also sort of continue in that direction. I wanted to study biology. I didn't get a place at the biology department of Shevchenko University and went to study physics, which I never regretted because I ended up doing my PhD in life sciences, but physics background is always helpful. So Shevchenko University is my alma mater. Later, when I was already doing PhD, I also did master studies in higher education management, which was an international program run at Kyiv Polytechnic Institute. So it's in a way another alma mater.
How has your Ukrainian experience influenced your academic development?
Very much, because my basic core education was done in Ukraine, and at least at the time I graduated in 92. This was a very solid basis, and doing a PhD in Ukraine was also, I believe, has a profound influence. I was very lucky to have my PhD supervisors was Professor Kutlakhmedov and at that time doctor, now Professor Mihail, in the Department of Biophysics and Radiobiology under leadership of academician Hrudzinski. And that was a very good school, both scientifically, but also like life school. We had a very good relationship, and the professional standards, I believe, were very high.
More about relocation and academic life in Germany. So how long do you live in Germany, and what were the reasons or motivation for relocation to Germany?
I ended up in Germany, I would say, who knows where I'll be in a few years or whatever, but basically, I at the time when I just graduated and did my PhD, I was looking for opportunities to develop my scientific career, and it was pretty clear. So 95, I did my PhD that doing further research in Ukraine is a challenge. I was lucky and supported by my PhD supervisor, Professor Kutlakhmedov, and got a scholarship in Denmark for 3 months. And that is the first time where I had an insight, what does it mean to work in a foreign lab with equipment and all the opportunities. So it was pretty clear to me that if I want to stay in science, it would be outside of Ukraine, or if I stay in Ukraine, then I'll do something else and not science. Also, just for very pragmatic reasons, one couldn't earn enough to rent a flat in Kyiv. So this was pretty clear. And I was basically looking at all options open to me. I was lucky or successful enough to get a scholarship. So the first scholarship after this short-term one was DAED, the German Academic Exchange Service scholarship in Germany. I was in Hanover. And after that, I actually had another set of scholarships or fellowships in the UK, where the majority of the bulk of my academic career was developed. I went to Oxford with a NATO Royal Society scholarship for postdocs. Then I had a Wellcome Trust fellowship, and I worked at Cardiff University. Then I did another postdoc at UCL in London, and pretty much I was basically in the UK. I also did the transition into from like lab bench science into more supportive role as a research development officer at Cardiff University, which was a permanent position at the university in the UK. And basically then this was until 2005. For family reasons, I met there in the UK my now husband, who is German. And at some point, we decided to move to Germany, where I felt, okay, I'm foreign there or there, and for him, it would be at home. And of course, being already in this research support role made the move a bit easier, because as a researcher, of course, you have much more limited opportunities. You have to find the lab with exactly they need expertise you have and at the time you want to move. So this is basically what happened. And since 2006, which is now 14 years, I live here in Berlin, or near Berlin, I would say.
When you moved the first time for a long-term period, which were the difficulties? Because as a foreign, there are a lot of difficulties and differences between Europe and Ukraine. So what were your difficulties?
I didn't perceive it as difficulties. I was very open to, for me, work was very important, and having an opportunity to work in a good lab, it was defining. The positive was also, although it was just a scholarship, and those who know the funding opportunities, the DAED scholarship is not extremely high, but I could rent an accommodation. At the time I was divorced. I had a son who was at the time 10. And for two of us, I could rent a good apartment in a nice part of Hanover, and basically could sustain myself being a scientist, which in Ukraine was impossible. So that was already a huge achievement. The difficulty was actually getting my son to join me. Germany has very strict regulations about minors, and I had these discussions with Foreign Office to get the permission to bring him with me, because they were saying, well, he can stay with grandparents, and why should he be with you? So that was for me also a cultural difference, in terms like in Ukraine, I believe nobody would question that it's like the best for the child to be with the parents. And there I was getting all these reasons like, oh, but he has friends in school there. It's like, yes, but he wants to be with his mother. So language-wise, I didn't have difficulties, because my work was English-based very much. I was learning German, and I found it difficult to improve it, because at the institute, we were all speaking English. And what I did notice that Germans were friendly, but their understanding of privacy and private sphere is very different to that of Ukraine. So there wasn't that much interactions outside of the institute. And of course, it was also making difficult to improve the language. And I remember my son once asked me, Mama, do Germans, how do they travel? Because he said, when I take a bus, people don't speak German on the bus. Well, maybe they drive a car. So it was just such an insight. But basically also for my son, he joined a special class for children of foreigners. And in half a year, he was good enough at German to move to a gymnasium to study further. So his German basically also developed quite well, but we then moved to England. So that was then not necessary anymore.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I probably should mention, I had also very good support by my supervisor, who helped a lot with writing and preparing this fellowship application for DAD, and then also absolutely helped me with finding the accommodation and doing all the arrangements and checking if I have enough cutlery in the kitchen. So I believe I was quite privileged and very well taken care of.
Yeah, it's pretty good that you had such opportunity, because when I moved to Germany, I didn't. So my professor, he didn't help us at all. And we had everything.
I guess this is very personal, and
yeah.
I think that it's possible that people have one experience and then they generalize, and this is unfortunate. As I say, when I then faced the difficulties with my son joining me, this was then not easy, and also not so easy for my supervisor, because he had no children. For him, this was just something like not necessarily supportive. So in that respect, there were certain difficulties. And then one, of course, generalizes a lot, because when I moved then to Oxford, my Oxford professor first took me by hand and we went to open a bank account, and he arranged for me an accommodation. And then he said, first you sort out school for your son, and when everything is sorted, then you come to the lab and then we'll talk what you would be doing. So this was really very personal and a very positive experience. Mm.
Yeah, it's very cool. Now also here I have a question. Has moving abroad influenced your academic career? So for example, you mentioned that you have been in another country for 3 months, right? For the like practic. So it was like your first experience, right? In your academic career. So did it already influence in your future academic career?
Well, I believe it was my ticket. It's extremely, was extremely important. This first, scholarship. It was a 3 month short-term scholarship from European Environment Research Organization. I believe it doesn't exist anymore, but at the time, this was post-Chernobyl time, and my research was related to radio ecology. The lab in Denmark was very advanced and specialized, and just seeing the opportunities, what one can do when one has resources, this was, of course, amazing. So it did strengthen me in my wish to pursue science and not just give up and look for other options as a professional development, which I was considering when I was in Ukraine, because, of course, with scholarships, or I was applying for positions abroad, I mean, you never know. It might work, it might not work. It was also very important in terms of English, because by that time, I already had reasonably good English, but my spoken English wasn't developed. Of course, I didn't have much practice. So those 3 months, they were quite crucial to activate the language to the operational level. So, and then from there, I was also applying for funding opportunities. I had access to papers, which I, of course, didn't have at the time in my institute. I saw job advertisements, so it pretty much opened the world of opportunities to me, which I was happy to try to use. It works for me. It may be not always working for everybody, but for me, this was definitely a defining experience.
Okay.
And on a personal level, maybe I'll just comment, it was also extremely interesting just to be one of postdocs and PhD students, so young researchers or early career researchers in this environment. We lived in a guest house, and it was a very international group. So there were a few British and you know, guys, and then somebody from the US. There was a lady from Belarus. There were Baltic countries represented, some French. And it was for me, for the first time, to not just visit, like at the conference, meet some foreign researchers, but actually like for 3 months to be in a very closed environment. So this was also very interesting experience and very positive to me.
And now, in order to close this section, I want to ask you one question. Which advices can you give to the young scientists, which, I don't know, for example, they want to work in another country, or they just want to go in the direction of science?
Well, I believe one has to, I don't feel good about giving advice. I'm not a matriarch for that, but I just feel it's important to believe in yourself, to also value the education and skills one got. My experience for a while, I was also a coordinator of PhD program at the MDC, and I had this experience of recruiting and seeing, like, sieving through thousands of applications for PhD students. And I can say that Ukrainian PhD students or candidates, so graduates from Ukraine, are extremely well qualified and very positively evaluated by our researchers, by the principal investigators. But when I was giving seminars in Kyiv, promoting our PhD program, I would hear like, oh, but you have such a competition, it's 20 person per place, oh, I have no chance. And I felt this, I would say, unfortunate Ukrainian mentality of being somehow second class, this menschowartist, this is really something one has to forget. One has to learn to be assertive and to value what one has. And in that respect, I probably would only say there is this saying, it's better to try and fail than to fail to try. That was my motto. And okay, I believe this is something that one can take as an advice.
Yeah, thank you. And here our last section four, it's like cultural or any differences between German and Ukraine. So we were talking about a little bit about some differences like in academic life, but have you experienced any cultural differences in the maybe everyday life, and what are they if they were?
Of course, I mean, all cultures are different, but in a way one has again to remember we're all Europeans, so we go back to very much the same sort of cultural codex. Of course, comparing now between Germany and Ukraine, there are certain differences, but it's the same if you compare people in Lviv and in Mykolaiv, for example. Then you go to the US and you understand that you're so European and it's so different that basically you really know different to German compared to the Americans. So in that respect, everything, there is a certain relativity, of course. I would say that somebody was comparing Ukrainians basically to South Europeans. We are more like Italians or Spanish, family values, warmth, extended family, very emotional, gesticulating a lot. Germans, especially if you would happen to work with people more like North Germany or rather conservative South Germany, they have more distance also in personal relation, like when you talk to them. And so it's important simply to keep that in mind, that when you are very open and emotional and show your passion, some might like it and some might perceive this is as unprofessional. This is just important to keep in mind that there are certain distances that also understanding of what privacy is. When you organize something and that's just taking a picture, this now especially people are much more concerned also with privacy. In Germany, it's a very important issue. This could be very different than in Ukraine, where people might not think about it. I maybe mention an experience we on Sundays, we do some dancing before Corona with my husband, and we were very friendly with other couples who were coming to dance. It's like a dancing school. But basically it took some 2 or 3 years before we started to say hi to each other and maybe even learn the name of each other, which I thought in Ukraine, you go somewhere on holidays and you start like talking immediately. And in half an hour, you know everything about grandchildren and who knows what, or neighbors, or really very personal stories. And here it does take time, but then it's also, you also learn to respect the distance. So now I also notice when I go back to Ukraine that, I feel my private space can be invaded very easily. And that's something that, of course, you can only learn when you live in different culture.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And also one question here, it's more about academic cooperation. So in which way do you support, or do you have any projects with like maybe Ukraine or German-Ukrainian projects, like joint projects together?
Well, I mentioned in the beginning that we founded German-Ukrainian Academic Society, and that's basically a big project, if you want. I hope it would live much longer than as a just a project. So it's a organization. We are counting almost 70 members, a few from Ukraine and a few now moved from Germany abroad, but majority are in Germany. The vast majority of our members are scientists of Ukrainian origin who are very successful here in Germany. And I support the society as managing director and also editor of our newsletter that we publish at least like 4 times a year, where we inform scientists here in Germany, but we have somehow I think 700 subscribers by now, so a lot from Ukraine as well, but also from other countries, in terms of the developments, cooperation highlights, funding opportunities for cooperation. So this is our contribution. We also run projects. So right now, like next week, there is a German-Ukraine alumni network run by Würzburg University. It's a their funded project, and they organize events where, for example, next week I would be given a small talk on funding opportunities for research cooperation with Ukraine. Our members and I also supported those activities, organized I think by now some like 20 summer schools where researchers from abroad, mainly from Germany as we are based here, but also from other countries, are coming to Ukraine and sharing their knowledge and experience with young researchers in Ukraine. Some people also apply for funding together. For example, there's recently funded huge teaming project funded by European Commission, where our member Denis Makarov was contributing significantly from German side. He works at Helmholtz Center Dresden-Rosendorf as a physicist. So basically I see my role as supporting and stimulating the collaboration between people and bringing information together. This is what I believe we can do, share our knowledge.
Okay, thank you a lot for the interview.
Thank you.